Good afternoon, everyone. It's so glad to see so many of you here. My name is Mark Manuel. I'm one of three new people on the Diversity Advantage team. I do diversity outreach and engagement. I'm the Diversity Outreach and Engagement Administrator, and I have a couple colleagues with me, Jennifer Meacham, who does the ADA and Title VI work, and Elena Castillo, whose primary focus is to look inward at the internal workings of the City of Bellevue in regards to diversity. We're very, very excited to be able to host Dr. Roberts today, but before I do that, I have the distinct honor and pleasure of introducing an active advocate for education and equality, a longtime trustee of the Bellevue Schools Foundation, and someone who has been instrumental in the development of Eastside Pathways. I feel really good about this. He has been an incredible champion of diversity and supported the initiation of the Diversity Advantage Plan from the very get-go. Not only has he shared his vision and leadership on Bellevue's council for 4 years, but he has a title change that has caused a lot of excitement and buzz within the walls of City Hall. Please join me in welcoming Mayor John Stokes.
Well, thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here. You know, to be in the same room with Dr. Terrance Roberts, for all of us is a thrill, and to me particularly. We both go back a long way. We just chatted briefly a minute ago, so he doesn't know a lot about me, but I'll tell you a little bit because it's relevant to this. I do want to start off by saying good afternoon and welcome to Bellevue for those of you who are joining us from further afield. And also want to say from the very top, it's very relevant. 2 years ago, City Council went to a retreat, and it wasn't a usual retreat. We was by ourselves with a facilitator and Brad and Myrna at the time. And we came up with our vision for the next 20 years and then our priorities and looking overall. And our top message and slogan, however you want to put it, is simply this: Bellevue welcomes the world. Diversity is our strength. And that's a powerful, powerful message coming from a city with the perceptions from the past of Bellevue. That's Bellevue now in the future. And to be here today with a living example of someone who has fought for that and who has gotten us to this point is a real honor. The other point, the connection is, I was in law school, George Washington University in D.C. I'm from Texas originally. In 1963, fall of 1963, and as you remember, there was an event that happened in D.C. at that time. Dr. Martin Luther King gave his "I Have a Dream" speech, and I went there, and I was in the back of the crowd, way back. There's a huge crowd all the way from the monument to Lincoln Memorial, and Dr. King was at the Lincoln Memorial, and I was kind of back towards the monument. But I was there on that day, and I'll, of course, never forget that. Many years later, I was the regional attorney for the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare in the Dallas region, includes Arkansas, Little Rock, and I've been to Little Rock. I've been in the school several times, and we, after the Charlotte-Mecklenburg decision with the Supreme Court in 1971, said, okay, quit fooling around, finish up and get the schools desegregated. So I, with along the Department of Justice, the Office for Civil Rights, I spent a considerable amount of time going around the five-state region and helping schools actually finish desegregating. So I've been involved in that for a long time, and that's why, to me, it's a very emotional part to come here and talk about this. You know, it says on here, and it is true, one of the best parts of my job, and I'm really pleased to be mayor, and that's because I get to meet really great people in these events. And we are in the presence, and honored to be all of us, in the presence of a true hero. And I don't know if you've ever seen the film about that time, but you have to see it and understand what these kids did, what they went through. It's truly amazing. We're talking today about someone whose courage and belief in equal opportunity has changed all the course of history. So Please help me welcome Dr. Terrance Roberts. Let's give him a big. A background, a 16-year-old boy in Little Rock, Arkansas. It's like another galaxy far, far away. Unfortunately, there's still problems there, but it's been progress. Dr. Roberts is one of nine students known as the Little Rock Nine who desegregated Central High School in 1957. It wasn't easy, and the children faced intense opposition from the community and were turned away from the school by the Arkansas National Guard. Imagine standing there and having all these guys in the uniforms and guns and bayonets and all that. President Eisenhower intervened, ordered federal troops to protect the Little Rock Nine for the school year. And think back to your time as a teenager and how raw some of those moments could be. Now imagine those trials and tribulations along with the added challenge of having a jury mob letting you know exactly how much they don't like and accept you, along with the real risk of being physically harmed. The tenacity of Dr. Roberts, 16-year-old kid, and the Little Rock Nine is part of the reason today we don't think twice about seeing children of all races learning in the same school. And the reason we can say diversity is our strength is because of this pioneer. We have over 84 different languages spoken in the Bellevue School District. And as said before, and I'm pleased to say, I've been a champion of education and the development, adoption, and implementation of the city's Diversity Advantage Plan. We know that diverse city is a better city, rich in ideas and shared experiences. And so it's very fitting today we have Dr. Terrance Roberts here to help us pay tribute to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who made it his life's work to promote racial equality and unity. So thank you very much for coming today to reflect on history and how it will shape the future conversation as we go forward on equity, access, inclusion, and opportunity in Bellevue and beyond. Again, please welcome Dr. Terrance Roberts.
We're going to start off this presentation with a very short video presentation to introduce some and remind others of the craziness that occurred in Little Rock in 1957.
What about you, sir? Do you think the colored students will show up?
If I got anything to do with it, they won't show up. Well, I think it's a breaking point of the school integration. I just don't feel that they have a right to go to school with
them. It is easy to believe today that we are an enlightened society, free from problems of race, gender, or economic separation. But some of the most difficult lessons we learn are a result of individuals who push us through these divisive barriers. In September of 1957, nine black school children, the eldest only 17, forced us through such a blockade. They sought a better education for themselves and the opportunity to pursue the American dream.
This is Central High School, Little Rock, Arkansas. Troops, which for nearly 3 weeks lined the sidewalk here in front of the high school under orders to keep the colored students out, have been replaced now. And their orders to comply with the law, which means let the Negro students in if they come in.
We were Terrance Roberts, Jefferson Thomas, Thelma Mothershed, Elizabeth Eckford, Ernest Green, Carlotta Walls, Melba Patillo, Minnie Jean Brown, and Gloria Ray.
They became known as the Little Rock Nine. The 1954 Supreme Court ruling on Brown versus the Board of Education found segregation of schools unconstitutional. But as the Little Rock Nine approached the high school, segregationists swarmed the campus.
I got no business out here. This is our school, not theirs. They are their own.
As the violence escalated, one schoolgirl, Elizabeth Eckford, was threatened by an angry mob chanting, "Lynch her, lynch her." President Dwight Eisenhower intervened in Little Rock and set a precedent for our nation as a whole.
Such an extreme situation has been created in Little Rock. This challenge must be met, and with such measures as will preserve to the people as a whole their lawfully protected rights in a climate permitting their free and fair exercise. In the present case, the troops are there pursuant to law solely for the purpose of preventing interference with the orders of the court.
On September 25, 1957, the 101st Airborne Division and 10,000 National Guard troops escorted the Little Rock Nine as they walked bravely past screaming mobs and made their way to the classrooms of Little Rock Central High School.
Just got a report here on this end that the students are in.
Do you feel it's worth it going through this?
Yes, I do.
These nine heroes were willing to step forward and in doing so altered the course of history. Marquette University is honored to bestow upon them the Pierre Marquette Discovery Award for this extraordinary contribution to the advancement of education for all people. The Little Rock Nine stand not just for racial equality, but also for the promise upon which our society is founded, opportunity and equality for all willing to strive, struggle, and achieve.
Thank you, Mark. That clip from Marquette University was done when the nine of us were invited to receive the Pierre Marquette Award. And it stands out as something very spectacular for me because only a few people have received that award. And among the four or five people who have, including us, were Mother Teresa and Bishop Tutu, Archbishop Tutu. Puts you in pretty rare company. Gives you pause. In any case, this whole business started in December of 1941. That's when I made my entry into the annals of humanity, only to discover that I was not a beloved child. I was considered a pariah at best. I was told in no uncertain terms that, boy, you have entered our society clothed in black skin. Did you not realize, did no one tell you that black skin is not the proper clothing for a real human being? And so by law and by custom, this message was presented to me in various and countless ways, day after day after day, inscribed in ways that cause you to wonder about the sanity of people around you. In fact, one of my early thoughts was that people in Little Rock were insane, and that perhaps outside Little Rock, perhaps here in Bellevue, there were sensible, sane, rational people. But I was quickly disabused of that notion as I began to ambulate around much later, find out that they're all crazy. But in any case, I was determined to stay alive in spite of that, because life seemed to be something that offered opportunity, that offered possibilities, and I wanted to be a part of that. So my second thought was, but how on earth are you going to do that, given this opposition? And then I discovered that this stuff had been in place for a lot longer than I realized. It wasn't something that had happened the week before I arrived. No. We can go back historically as far back as the year 1619. Oh, I think I'll do something here, since a lot of bright people in the room. We're going to do a math assignment. We're going to do a timeline that stretches from 1619 to 1954. How many years between 1619 and 1954? Those of you with smartphones, feel free to use them. If they are, in fact, needed. And the answer is 335. See, I told you, room full of bright people. 335 years. Now, I want you to consider that well, because during that 335 years, it was considered to be legal, constitutional, if you will, to discriminate on the basis of racial group membership. Think about that. How many people do you know who have been around for 335 years? Not that many, but you get a sense of what this means, generation after generation of people. I was born in 1941. Which was before the end of our timeline. The 1954 end of the timeline is there because that's the year in which the Supreme Court rendered its decision in Brown v. Board of Education. Some of you were actually alive when that happened. Some of you in the room are so new to the universe, this may be news. But that particular decision meant that my life was going to change. I didn't know how, but I knew something was going to happen. When I was born in 1941, this country was still under the aegis of the Plessy v. Ferguson decision, which had been rendered in 1896, which codified what had been going on before, and that is that it is legal and constitutional to maintain these walls of separation. 54 decision said, no, that's not true. This is unconstitutional. Well, who knows the truth of the matter? In fact, whatever the Supreme Court decides, it really doesn't matter in terms of what human beings decide they're going to do. Which to me means that in this year, 2016, we are still trying to make what some people call progress. But make no mistake, folk, we have not made any progress. Now, for some of you, that's going to be a rather discordant note. When you look around you and you say, well, things are different. Yes, they are different. Does that mean progress because they're different? No, no. And we'll get into that as we talk together, because we most certainly will talk together. We're going to reserve time for dialogue between me and thee. Okay. Any rate, so there I am in Little Rock, freshly minted, straight out of the womb, having spent 9 months gestating in a very nice, comfortable amniotic bubble. But then I appeared as a fully formed infant human being with possibilities. And as I grew and developed, I began to take in all of the information that was there for the taking. And by the way, this country is really good in one sense, that information is available. I had to really dig for my information. All you have to do is talk to Siri and you get yours. But the fact is, it's there. I soaked it up like a sponge because I needed to know. I needed to know why people thought the way they thought, why they acted the way they acted. Just made, you know, no sense for me not to know. I was shocked as I began to discover all the things. Not only did I discover about the timeline starting in 1619, I discovered some of the crazy stuff that had been going on. By the way, I'm currently in the midst of reading a book that I highly recommend to you. It's called The American President, from Theodore Roosevelt to William Clinton, written by historian William Luchtenberg. I think he's at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, if I'm not mistaken. But in any case, wonderful historian, competent researcher, and the book is essential reading if we want to understand what goes on, truly goes on, in governing from the president's position. Well, anyway, back to this little kid in Little Rock. Eventually, I went to school. And this made all the sense in the world because I discovered the magic of learning. You know, the largest possession any of us have is a storehouse of ignorance. I don't know anything, and you don't either, which makes me feel comfortable in your midst. But that does not have to remain a permanent condition. You can learn your way out of that ignorance, but it's hard work. You really do have to work at it. Most people don't do that, by the way. Most people are content to exist on sound bites and buzzwords, and they are vulnerable to the powerful voices out there who will get their attention, as we have seen in this latest round of vying for the Republican presidential nomination. At any rate, I was shocked by it all, but again, since I was determined to continue living, I kept plunging in. And what I discovered was this, that my storehouse of ignorance did not diminish immediately. It grew. Why? Because as you start learning, you are impressed with the fact that you really know a lot less than you thought you knew. But that only inspires you to keep learning, keep reading. And for the younger people in the crowd, I say today, here's a good example, this table right here. Your task is to read like you, your life depended upon it. Okay, here's the assignment. One book a week from now on. Okay? Are you objecting? Because if you object, I'm going to increase it to two. Why? Because it's through the written word
that we gain a lot of what we need to know. And it's free. There are libraries available. That was one of the things I loved about growing up. I could go to the library. Now, as a black kid in Little Rock, I did not have access to the main library, of course. No, that was reserved for white people. You can see how idiotic it is? But there was this small branch called the Ivy Branch. Where they got that name, I don't know. But that was where I had to go. But I fully embraced it. I read every book in the Ivy Branch Library. And that did not satiate my need to know. So I kept finding texts wherever I could. And so it is today. And that's why I'm in the middle of this book on the presidents. By the way, the book I just read before that was The Letters of Kurt Vonnegut, which I also highly recommend, The Collected Letters of Kurt Vonnegut. You cannot believe what an important man he was. Anyway, and so on and so on. Okay. Something about that that really lights fires. And you never know what direction you're going to take. So then I got to school. I went to first grade. First grade teacher said to all of us six-year-olds assembled in her midst, she said, "You know, kids, you kids must take on executive responsibility for learning. You have to become the CEO of your own independent learning enterprise." That resonated. I could feel it in my bone marrow that this is important stuff. So right there, in September 1947, I established the Terry Roberts Learning Academy. It has been operational since with no interruption. It makes sense. The only difference between any two people in the universe is how much either one knows. That's the only difference. How much is known? See, it has nothing to do with culture or ethnicity or race or any of that crazy stuff. That's not the essential differences. It's how much you know. And why is that so important? Because the more you know, the more options you have available to choose from when you're at that point of decision making. What if you have only a few options? What will life be like if you have to go through life exercising one or two options that you know, when in fact billions of options exist in this universe? And that's the truth. Billions of options. And what was it? Was it Mae West or Tallulah Bankhead? I can't remember who said it, but it's so profound. Life is a banquet, and most of you SOBs are starving to death. Wow. Anyway, so first grade gets me off to a really good start. And the other thing I discover is that because of this system of segregation, all of the teachers in my school are black people. All the administrators, the janitors, the bus drivers, anybody in that whole institutionalized process of public education, they're black because of segregation. Found out something else about that. Many of the teachers who taught me were people who were well-educated, but they couldn't get jobs in their chosen fields of endeavor because they were black people. But they could teach. So we had the best and the brightest. They took it upon themselves to channel their energy rather than put that energy into anger or being upset. They channeled that energy into us. They focused on us and demanded excellence. They said, "You will learn." And they did not spare the rod. And we did not have those crazy things about child abuse. No, we were abused, but we learned. We managed to deal with that. We managed to come through that with vision, with understanding that learning was essential. It makes such a difference. Then as I made my way through the school system, by the way, I learned something else too. This is just a side note, that when you realize that in the main, school systems are not there to educate. No, they're not. So students have to learn how to cope with those systems, how to manage those systems, and also learn. So you got two agendas. You got to deal with the craziness of the school bureaucracy, you know, and you also have to spend time learning. Don't worry about it. That's just the way it is. Deal with it, okay? Important learning, though, because it serves you well in life itself. Then, when in 1954, when the Supreme Court ruled in the Brown case, I lit up. I thought, wow, this is exciting. The law is on my side. This is the very first time ever. I was 13 years old. That same summer of my 13th summer, something happened to me that made it all fit together. I walked into a place in Little Rock called a Crystal Burger, hamburger joint. That was before I had become enlightened about diets, and I would go in and eat the stuff they had. They called it food, and I ate it. But I went in and I ordered this hamburger with cheese and fries and malt. But the rule was, because it was a white-owned establishment, as a black person, you could not sit down. You could order the food, but you had to stand and wait while it was prepared, and then you took it out to eat. It was food to go. The Crystal Burger was unlike many other such institutions that served black people. In other places, you could go to the back door or a side window, but the Crystal Burger actually allowed you to walk through the front door. Wonder of wonders. So I walked in on this particular day, and I had been there many times, so I knew the drill, I knew the routine, I was not confused. But when I made my order, I looked around, and the restaurant was sparsely populated, not many patrons. Empty seats at the counter, empty chairs around the tables. After I made the order, I just popped up on a stool at the counter to wait. At which point, everything in the Crystal Burger came to a grinding halt, and all the heads turned to look at me. Silence enveloped the place. Hamburgers in mid-flip. And then all of a sudden, I realized I've made a mistake. I could be killed. I jumped down off that stool, canceled my order, and ran out. And at that moment, I had this epiphany, and I had this emotional feeling. It was as if something inside of me snapped. And the thought was, Terry Roberts, you can no longer go through this charade of pretending to obey these rules. I was a gone goose, because I knew that now I would be more vulnerable than ever. But I went home in this emotional mess. My mom, prescient creature that she was, didn't bother me. She allowed me to go into my room and deal with it, which she did with all of her kids. All seven of us had learned to cope with stuff on our own. Oh, we got advice and counsel, but she did not coddle. And eventually, I came to the realization that it's going to be a new world from now on. You're not going to be one of those kids who will follow the rules, and you could be killed. So you better be very circumspect. So I led a very cautious life. And then, in that next year, 1955, the Little Rock School Board determined that they were going to obey the law. Wonder of wonders. Wow, the Little Rock School Board, law-abiding, wow. So they put together a plan to desegregate schools, and they came up with a brilliant plan, kindergarten through third grade. And I put that to you. Would a desegregation program at K-3 work? Of course. How many times have you picked up the Bellevue International Times to read Race Riot in Kindergarten, right? No, probably doesn't happen. But the townspeople figured it out too, and they were not happy. They confronted the school board en masse and said, no way are you going to implement that plan. We will not stand for it. School board was forced to capitulate, and they came back with grades 10, 11, and 12. Now, while that did not completely mollify the opposition, they were okay with it, because they reasoned that we've had these kids submersed in the ideology of white supremacy for lo these many years. They will not allow this to happen. And so, as they say in the streets, perhaps here in Bellevue, it was on. So the nine of us show up, and the opposition is manifested. Led by the governor and his minions, the National Guard, as you saw, they kept us out. They were good. I was telling somebody this morning that I walked up to school that day, and the guards were lined up all around the school. But I saw white kids streaming in through a break in the line, so I figured this is the entry point. No one told me, but I figured it out. I'm a smart kid. So I walk over, and by the time I got there, though, the ranks closed. They wouldn't let me in. But I didn't think too much about it, because I saw a white kid streaming into an opening on my left, a few yards over. So I thought, ah, a shifting point of entry, probably for security reasons. So I go over. I attempt to get in that, and again they close ranks, at which point lights went on. Ha! Ha! I got it. They're not letting me in. I was naive, but not totally stupid. So I went home. We, the nine, were locked out of that school for about a span of 3 weeks. At which point, the president did act. This is true. Although I don't want you confused about the acts of Eisenhower, okay? He did not act out of being a champion of civil rights. Far from it. Read Luchtenberg for more details. But in any case, he did act. We got in. And then all hell broke loose because we had breached the citadel. And this was not tolerable. No way. So the message was, either you leave voluntarily or we'll drag you out, dead or alive, doesn't matter. And so they came at us. We, the nine, adopted a platform of nonviolence, which made sense for me. The very mention of nonviolence got my attention because I have never seen the efficacy of fighting. Fighting makes no sense to me whatsoever. And in fact, I had learned from my mom that fighting was not a human activity. You know how she reasoned? She said this. She said, Terry Roberts, she used to talk that way, Terry Roberts, you are an animal, this is true, but you are a human animal, and as such, you never have to fight. You have at your disposal tools to help you resolve conflict. You have the power of speech. You have brains. You can negotiate. You can compromise. You can share. You don't have to be like smaller animals, rats, cats, with small brains. Their default response is to fight. Why would you ever want to be a rat? Whoa, the imagery was so overwhelming. I said, oh no, not me. I'm going to be a human. I am not going to fight. Plus, I had heard the golden rule. You know that rule? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. In fact, when I first heard that, I was in church. And the golden rule was mentioned, I jumped up off the pew. Hallelujah. Life's going to be grand. I'm not doing anything to anybody. Except the problem is, not everybody reads the rule. Or if they read it, they misinterpret it. As one guy said, his rule, do unto others before they do unto you. Well, as a consequence, we were at risk. We walked into a den of people who didn't understand the principles and the nuances of nonviolence. They saw us simply as stationary targets, which meant I had to go to option two, which is to run. And by the way, young people, especially young men in the room, running is honorable. And I say that because I spoke to a middle school group not too many months ago, and a young middle school boy stood up and he said, Dr. Roberts, I think it's crazy. I have to fight. Really? Yes. Why? I have to protect my manhood. My manhood's challenged. I have to fight. I said, are you sure about that? He says, yes, I'm sure. I said, well, what about running? Oh, no, you can never run. That's cowardly. I said, actually, young man, in my thinking, your manhood would be better served if you ran with it to someplace safe. Well, he was not impressed. He was not impressed. But we were assailed, we were attacked, we were harassed, we were, in fact, anything that you can think of that one human being might possibly do to another, they did to us. Vile things. My daughter, my youngest daughter, was at the Central High Museum not long ago, maybe a couple of years, and we were separated, and I looked over, she was sitting at a table with headphones, copious tears, just crying away. And I ran over and took up the extra set of headphones and looked at the screen she was watching. And there was a student, or former student, who was there when I was a student. And he was describing an incident that involved me. Things that had happened to me that I had not shared with my daughter. So it was a double whammy for me because I agonized about her discomfort and her emotional upset because I hadn't told her. But then I felt that same kind of helplessness. What do you do? But it was like that during the year. All of that stuff, all the time. But at any rate, I was a resilient kid. And maybe youth helped because young people have that sense of immortality. Nothing can happen to you, which served us well. Plus, I could run. I am really fast. I can outrun you. Challenge, throw down the gauntlet, right? I mean, when you are dedicated, when you have a goal, and that is to preserve your life, you will find speed. Anyway, this happened throughout the year. Now, one of our group got kicked out of school. Some of you know the story of Minnie Jean Brown. Minnie Jean, she's a Chile incident person. At least the historians talk about it as a Chile incident, although Minnie Jean would inform you if she were here today that it wasn't just Chile. Oh, no. It was the chili, yes. But it was also the jello, the salad, the bread, the milk. What had happened, she was in the cafeteria, and she was approaching her seat, and some kid pushed his chair out to impede her progress. And she stood there with her tray, and you could see the little wheels clicking, and the decision, should I or should I not share my lunch with this kid? She decided in the affirmative, and he found himself covered with today's menu. The next day, some kid returned the favor, poured food over Minnie Jean, at which point she gave up voluntarily the principles of nonviolence and began to defend herself with some vigor. The school officials, in their infinite wisdom, said, Minnie Jean, for your own safety and well-being, we're kicking you out of school. She was expelled. That was the official story. The unofficial story, they kicked Minnie Jean out of school because she was now beating up a whole lot of white kids. I mean, she was tough. She could fight. I couldn't fight. I would never even think about having those kind of credentials, but she did know how to fight. I mean, I wouldn't tangle with her, I know that. Anyway, so they kicked her out. But the upshot of that, in the wake of her expulsion, little cards were printed up and circulated all over that campus. One down, eight to go. So the pressure was cranked up on the rest of us. So with this increased pressure, we had to redouble our efforts to be nonviolent, which was mostly mental, internal activity. But I use a lot of mental tools to get through. Use my brain, my thought process. I had this rating scale for the quality of insults. I rated every insult on the basis of creativity. So if a person hurled an insult in my direction, I would not be offended by it. I would simply want to hear it so that I could rate it. And my scale ran from 0 to 10. 0, not good. 10, ooh, I might use that. But nobody scored above 2 the entire year. Kids were not creative. This kid, I remember, on one Tuesday, I was tempted to tell him, that's the same kind of nigger you called me yesterday. Where's your creative energy? I didn't say it, though. I didn't want to embarrass him. You know, there's nothing more confusing to me than an ignorant bigot. I got a lot of hate mail that year. And honestly, my instant response to the hate mail was to correct the grammar. These folk could not write a simple sentence. And it's tragic when you think about it, because these are the folk who are eligible to vote, who have driver's license, who make decisions that impact the lives of other people, well, et cetera, et cetera. Some of them probably live in Bellevue. I need a complete list by the end of the day. But any rate, so I'm going to pause here, and we're going to start our dialogue, because we have until 1 o'clock? Yeah, this is good. We have 20 minutes, which isn't a whole lot of time, but it is sufficient amount of time to get us rolling. And so your questions and comments will become the catalytic agents to spur this dialogue. And this is the most important part for me, because I begin to learn where your heads are in terms of the nature of your questions. And without wanting to put pressure on too many people, before you who have the first question, raise your hand.
So what was it like between the kids and the teachers?
Ah, spoken like a true educator.
Are
you a teacher?
No.
No, okay. Usually it's a teacher who asks that question, because it's basically, what would I have done in that situation? But what she said was, how did the teachers react to us? And these were all white teachers, by the way. Before we nine showed up, everybody in that school was white. Teachers were placed along a continuum from one extreme of being supportive of our presence, very few, to hating us with vile passion, most of them. Okay, and they all sort of lean in that direction. I had representatives from all along that continuum. My algebra teacher was in total support of my presence. In fact, in her classroom, nobody heard me. But in my English class, oh, here was a woman who hated me with vile passion. She had a face. I would replicate her face here for you if I could, but I don't know how one human being is able to scrunch up his or her face to that degree. She could do it, seemingly with ease. Unmistakable message. She confronted me one day. She said, why do you want to come to our school? Why don't you go back to your own school? This is her message. My response, which I did not verbalize, was, there is something wrong with you. You seem to be insane. Why? Because she's intimating that she and I have ownership in these public institutions, i.e. her school, my school. I knew I didn't own any such school, and I truly wondered about her. So what did I do? I just smiled and walked off. Now, I've since come to appreciate smiling and walking off as my response to idiocy wherever I find it, on the basis that it's a waste of time to try and have conversation with a person who is incapable of holding up her end. Why put people through that agony? Just leave the place. Thank you. In the back.
Hi. As a sociologist, can you elucidate on the difference between the segregation by the snarling racists in the South and the socioeconomic gentrification of the smiling racists in the Northwest, West, East Coast, and all coasts?
I can.
One other question,
but let me answer this one before I forget.
Okay.
Having spent 74 years wandering this universe, my memory is not what it used to be. But actually, my answer is quite simple. There is no difference.
I'm sorry to call a question.
No, you're fine.
But on Martin Luther King Day, as you look around this room, is somewhat hypocritical, because diversity and multiculturalism here is non-existent in the corporate and government sector. African Americans in Washington are being displaced and discriminated against by people who were not on the front lines of Dr. King's movement, but we're being discriminated against and displaced in employment by white women, East Asians, Asian foreigners, and gays waving the rainbow flag, people who were not on the front lines of the civil rights movement. And could you also comment on the mass exodus of northern blacks like me from Wisconsin who are returning to the South because there are better opportunities for us?
Okay, a couple of things. You're right in that assessment, but that is the American way. And also, I would have you recalibrate your geographical map so that from now on, the South is anything south of Canada. So you have not returned to the South. You've always been in the South. And you've learned to cope with it wherever you have been. See, part of the reality is, and you're right to point out what you pointed out. I have no quarrel with that. But that is business as usual. Question is, are we, the people, willing to change that? That's the essential question. So far, the answer has been a loud, consistent no. I don't know what it will take to make that a yes. But that's where we are. And I was explaining over lunch to a couple of my lunchmates that, unfortunately, because of who we have chosen to be collectively, there seems to be such an ongoing lack of will to even accept that reality as it is, but we change it and change the rhetoric so that it seems to be something that it's not. And that's unfortunate. I think, though, that if we individually go naked to the mirror and ask ourselves, who is the truth of me? Sounds a little crazy in terms of its construction, but it's true. Who is the truth of me? And confront self to the degree that awareness is raised, responsibility is taken, and choices are obviously different over time from that point on. That could make a big change. We could do it if we so desired. That's the essential question. I live in Pasadena, California. I live in an area where my wife and I happen to be the only, I was going to say the only people of color. That's changed in recent months. 2 months ago, a family moved in across the street who happened to be Chinese. But we were the only people of color there for 29 of our 30 years. It's been a very interesting experiment in sociology, if you will, in terms of how people deal with us. For a long time, it was very common for passersby on the street, if I were out gardening, to ask for my card, which I would freely give them. But it tended to stop all conversation at that point. I'm a fairly competent psychologist. I thought, you know, if you want my card, I will certainly give it to you. But it's at that level. It's at that level. And that's not unusual. Now, I don't get upset by that, honestly. I don't. It's important for us to be able to recognize that it makes no sense for you to be offended at every offensive thing out there, because that would be your life's work, to be offended. Question is, are you willing to exist in that reality, but do the work on yourself that is so needful? And that's true for all of us. Self-work is essential. You must do that work. I do it. I have to do it. Like you, at birth, I was immersed in this cauldron of racism. Immersed in it. No defense, because when you're an infant, you have no defense. You just get baptized into those waters. And over time, it has an impact, but at some point, there's a conscious choice to continue that or do something different. That is essential. The essential choice. Okay. Yes, sir.
Your time as a student is most often connected to the classic civil rights movement and that era of nonviolent social movement, and that school of thought about social movements. After the 1960s, what social movements and causes have you personally found most challenging?
This question is, what movements or causes have I found the most challenging since the classic civil rights era? Let me make a general comment about that particular way of thinking about things. As a people, we sort of revel in our ability to encapsulate things into eras and to cordon them off with timetables. I don't think you can really do that. And we can actually only do that in hindsight. It becomes easy to do it in hindsight because you have parameters. And we do use it. I use it all the time myself in lieu of some more exact way of thinking about things. But I answered a question recently. A young man asked me this question, similar to yours, but different in a way. He said, he recognized my being involved in the Little Rock activity, and he said, what have you done lately? And I thought about it. It's a legitimate question. I said, young man, I consider myself to have been conscripted into the Civil Rights Army on December 3rd, 1941, and I have been a continuous soldier since that time with no relief. So in a sense, that's exactly the answer I would give you, that my whole life is that of being a civil rights warrior. Given the circumstance, it can't be otherwise. It cannot be otherwise, because the need is still there. Years ago, Malcolm X was questioned about his unwillingness to underscore the progress made in the country. And he thought about the question and he said, you know, when you talk about progress, I look at it this way. If you plunge a 10-inch knife into my back and then you remove it 2 inches and you want to celebrate progress, we've got an 8-inch misunderstanding. And more than that, we have to consider rehabilitation, healing, and make up for lost opportunity, et cetera, et cetera. So it's that complicated when you think about it. I have actually improved a bit. I said today there's been no progress. If my wife were here, I couldn't say that because she's always on my back. Terry, don't say that. People will be offended. I, on the other hand, have great confidence in your ability to handle what I say. And so I put it out there, not as something that you believe, but this is what I believe. See, from my vantage point, here's how it all happened. I was having this argument with a woman once about progress, and I was being very radical about it. What are you talking about progress? Well, at any rate, it allowed me at that point to realize what I was doing. I measure progress not by what we have achieved, but by what we have yet to achieve. And when I look at that, there's such an endless list. We've done nothing. There's so much. There's so much. Now, if you are fortunate enough to have been born into society as a so-called white person, and I say so-called because race is mythological, then it's impossible for you to see it from my vantage point. I realize that. But that's how it is. I can't do anything about that. But we can't have dialogue about it. By the way, speaking of dialogue, I'd like to introduce you to a brand new website talkingaboutrace.com. No spaces, talkingaboutrace.com. This is a brazen pitch because this is a new business developed by my wife and I. But as you read it, you'll understand some of why I'm making these statements. Because what we want to do, what our goal is to involve ourselves in helping people come to a greater understanding of the dynamics of race, starting with dissolution of this notion that it is real. Well, no, that's the wrong thing to say. It is real, it's just not valid. It's mythological. See, myth is real. Speaking of which, there's this great book by the Field sisters, Barbara and her sister, I've forgotten her sister's name, called Racecraft. Racecraft, wonderful book. She compares racecraft to witchcraft. See, there was a time in this country when we believed in witches, and we kill people on the basis of their being witches. And today, we put people in prison on the basis of their race. You see a lot of parallels. A lot of parallels there. But it's all mythological. By the way, the truth of the matter is, for those of you who wonder about this, find it hard to wrap your minds around the fact that race is a myth, who you are in terms of your physiognomy has nothing to do with race. It's all about ancestry. Yeah. Have you ever noticed the color palette for African Americans? We run the gamut from ebony to ivory. Yeah. You know how that all happened? Ancestry. See, the rules of segregation were well in force until sundown. Alrighty. Yes.
Wondering, as the mother of teenage boys and involved with a lot of youth in the community, very community, the moms and dads of the nine, what did they teach you? How did they get you out the door? How did they had to choose your clothes, how you were going to look on TV. They had to go through all that. Have they ever talked back to you about?
Well, you of course make a lot of assumptions there, but I'll go with them. But our parents were wonderful. Our question is about the response of the parents of the nine. We were at school when the school board sent representatives to present this idea of the plan for desegregation. They rolled it out, called for volunteers, and the count was off by at least one, since both my hands were up. We went home, and there were about 150 of us who had volunteered in the two schools, Dunbar Middle, the ninth graders, and the Horace Mann High School, grades 10, 11, and 12. 150 of us went home that day, but at the end of the day, there were nine, because of what parents knew. Parents knew that this was not going to be an easy thing to accomplish, and they were concerned about the well-being and in fact, the continued life of their own child. So they vetoed. You could hear the veto stamps all over Little Rock. In the households of the nine of us, as personified by my parents, who said, we will support your decision 100%. And they added, if you get up there and it's really too hot and you want to quit, we will support your decision to quit 100%. At which point I knew I had the best of all worlds. I could stay there or leave without fear of losing parental esteem. So good. I didn't realize how much I used that until we got deep into the year when I had to rely on that. Because I did want to quit. Oh, I so desperately wanted to quit. Every second of every day I wanted to run screaming out of there because it was hard. It was hard dealing with that stuff. And it hurt. I mean, physically, psychologically, emotionally, there was pain all the time. And yet, something inside me said, it's not about you, Terry Roberts. This is not about you. This is bigger than you. You have been chosen to be here. That's how I felt. I felt like I had been chosen. Out of all the people in the universe, I was one of these nine folk. But the finger came down and said, you go. And yes, sir.
It's a twofer. Going back to no progress. What do you look to sustain you, and what should we look to sustain us going forward when we say no progress?
That's a very good question. And for me, it has to do with knowing and understanding who you are as an individual yourself. So that all the stuff that swirls around you, all the knowledge you have about the decision-making processes at the institutional levels, all of the little mechanisms used, all of the wide pools developed out of which we select the candidate, and the candidate is always not you, that sort of thing, understand that that's not personal. Not at all. And it may or may not change, but you can't allow that to deter you from pushing towards your own goals. That's important. That's important. There's a saying in Jewish tradition called Tikkun Olam. In that tradition, each individual in the universe is required to work toward repair of the world. But work toward repair of the world with the full knowledge that that can never be accomplished. But even with that knowledge that it can never be accomplished, you are not exempted from doing. And so it's sort of like that.
So the second part is your experiences, the experiences of the 8 or 9, in reconciliation, meaning going back, have a conversation with both teachers, some of who were on the not at all supportive part of the scale, and fellow students, many of whom were poor mentors. What conversations or things have happened in terms of reconciliation, going back and seeing some of those people again?
We've had some of that. We've had some of that, and we've also had something a little different from that, of people doubling down, saying, I am not about to change, or offering up this very flimsy excuse, well, I was just a teenager, which I don't accept. South Africans went through this process of reconciliation, and I think it happened in that country because the dynamics were different. There was a willingness to accept the reality on both sides, the oppressor and the victims, that this happened and we're sorry about it. We've not reached that point in this country. There's a lot of denial in this country. Often, it's difficult to have an open conversation about these issues because people are in such denial, or they want to blame ancestors, not understanding that they're enjoying the fruits from those ancestors. There's got to be some culpability here in the back.
We've got time, just before we begin, I just want to let you know we've got time for just one more question, so we'll end it with you.
So we have this spoiler over here.
During the time that the military and presumably law enforcement engaged in getting in and out of school, however long that time period was, what was the interaction with the students with the military, if any at all?
Oh, yes, we had a lot of interaction with the military. We were kept out of the school for about 3 weeks, and then when the army came, they laid down a different law, and they assigned guards to us to walk with us from class to class. Now, they were limited to a degree because the rules were that they could not enter the classrooms or the bathrooms or the gym or the cafeteria or the auditorium or the chapel or the library, but they could be in the hallway outside the door, which left us vulnerable in those spaces. But they were good. I mean, many times the soldiers would alert me to the fact that there was an ambush planned just outside, go through another door. That was cool. And all year, my default option was, if something really goes bad, I'll jump behind these soldiers and they will mow people down. That would not have worked because they didn't have any ammunition. But fortunately, I didn't know that. But, okay, so that was our last question group. We have work to do, you know, really official stuff. So we're going to leave, but with one last admonition. If what you know hasn't changed you already, change what you know. Go forth and do well.